In this lesson, we're going to deploy a EC2 instance in a public subnet as a Bastion host, and then use that to jump to an EC2 instance in a private subnet. So basically what we covered in the previous lesson in that theory. And this diagram basically shows what we're going to do. We're going to use the default VPC in this case, which already has a public subnet, and we already have a route table correctly configured and an internet gateway attached to the VPC. What we then need to do is create a private subnet with a route table, and then we're going to be able to launch our instances in the appropriate subnets and then connect in and jump from our public instance to our private instance. I'm in the VPC management console here, which you can find under services. Just scroll down to networking and content delivery and VPC. Now, I haven't covered the theory behind VPC in much detail yet. I'm going to build you up to that, and we're going to go into a lot of depth later on in the course. For now, I'm just going to give you the information you need to know so that you can deploy your EC2 instances and then your load balancers and auto-scaling groups within a VPC. So a VPC is essentially a virtual private cloud. That's a kind of virtual data center in the cloud. Now, I'm connected to the North Virginia. This is a regional service. You can select a region. I suggest you also use US East North Virginia. That's going to make this particular exercise a lot easier. So we have VPCs here under your VPCs, and this is the default VPC. Every single region will have a default VPC. The default VPC will have a subnet in each availability zone. So we have 6 subnets here because US East North Virginia has 6 availability zones. If I change to another one like Sydney, for example, we can see we only have 3 subnets, and that's because Sydney only has 3 availability zones. So back to US East North Virginia. So we can see our 6 subnets, each in a different availability zone. If I scroll all the way across here, I can see that the auto-assigned public IP addresses configuration setting is set to yes for all of these. These are public subnets. Now, if I go to route tables, we'll find there's one route table for that default VPC. This route table has a route for the actual CIDR block, so the overall address block, the IPv4 address block for the VPC of local. So remember, that means that it's going to route within the VPC. And then it has the IP address block for all other addresses via the internet gateway. You can find your internet gateway here, and this one is attached to our specific default VPC. So all of that is set up for us. We don't need to do anything here. You'll see how to create your own VPC later on. Now, what I want to do is create a private subnet. So firstly, I need to know the IPv4 address block to use for this particular subnet. It has to be within the overall CIDR block for the VPC. CIDR stands for classless inter-domain routing, and it's another concept we'll cover later on in the course. When we look at these IP addresses, we can see that they all start with 172.31, and then it's different. We have .0, .16, .32, .64, and .80. And then it's a .0/20, and that's the subnet mask. Again, we'll cover those concepts in more detail later. For now, I just want you to follow my instructions. Now, I'm going to copy this one to my clipboard just to make life easier and click on Create Subnet. And what I'm going to do is choose my VPC, scroll down to where it says IPv4 CIDR block, paste this in, and then I'm going to delete the 80. And I know that the next address range is 96. So I'm going to add that in. Now I want to give the subnet a name. I want to know that it's private, so I'm going to call it private. I want to know which VPC it's connected to, so I'm going to put -def for default. And I want to know which availability zone. I'm going to put 1A here and then choose the availability zone. So now from the name, I know some important information about this subnet. You can then add new subnets and add more, but I'm just going to create this particular subnet. So that subnet's created. We've got a filtered view here. And if I scroll all the way across, you can see the auto-assigned public IPv4 is no. So we're not going to get a public IP address. So that's the correct setting for a private subnet. Now also, we want to associate this subnet with a route table that does not have an internet gateway. At the moment, it's actually going to be associated with our public subnet routing table, the one that does have an internet gateway. And that's an implicit association. We haven't explicitly defined that it should be associated with that route table, but there's no other option. So the default route table is chosen. So what we're going to do is create a route table. We're just going to give this a name. I'm going to call it private-rt, select my VPC, and then just create the route table. Now I can go to subnet associations, choose edit subnet associations, and I'm going to select my private subnet and click on save. So now when we look at the subnet associations, we should see an explicit subnet association with our private subnet. So that's great, that's all set up correctly. Let's now go to EC2. In EC2, we're going to launch a couple of instances. I'm going to choose to launch an instance, Linux 2 AMI, T2 Micro, and this time I'm going to make sure I put it in a particular subnet. Now, I'm happy with this one going into 1A, but it's going to be the public 1A. So we should see that the auto assign public IP under subnet setting is enabled. So that's the default. So that's good. Let's click on next, come through to tags, security groups, select our web access security group. And we should have a rule for port 22 because I'm going to use the secure shell protocol. And that's from any source. So let's launch this instance. And that's on its way. Now let's launch another instance. And this one is going to go into a different subnet. So this one is going to go to our private subnet. So again, let's just go through, add a security group. We're also going to need SSH. And let's just launch this EC2 instance. Now you need to make sure you've got your key pair available. Now you might want to actually give these some names here. So this one is public. And this one I'm going to call private. And that's just going to make things a bit easier to identify here in the console. So we now have our public instance and our private instance. And what we're going to do is connect from our computers through our internet gateway to the public IP of this instance, and then from there to this instance. Now, there's one problem, and that is that I have my key pair file on my computer, which means I can connect to this instance. Remember, I need to present my key pair file in order to be able to connect to this instance. But this instance does not have a copy of that key file. So how can we connect from here to here? It's not going to allow that connection unless we have that particular key file available that we can present when we're connecting with SSH. So there is a way that we can do that, and it's called agent forwarding, which I'm going to show you how to do now. To use agent forwarding, we need to follow a particular process, and I've documented that in this blog article. I'll add a link to this to the video, and there'll also be a link to a similar article from AWS. And what we need to do is we're going to run this command SSH add, and that's going to add our private key file to SSH so that it can then be used in subsequent commands. And that means we're able to then connect to our public instance, and we'll still have the key file stored in memory that we can then use to connect to our private instance. Now, it's a bit different if you're on Linux or on Mac, and there's also instructions here for how to do it on Windows if you're using the PuTTY tool. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to follow the instructions up here to use the SSH add command with my Mac. On a command line here, I'm in a directory where I have the key file I need. So I can run ssh-add- and then I can put in the name of my key file, which is cloudlabs-nv.pem. So that identity has been added. And now I can connect to my EC2 instance. So back in the EC2 management console, I'm going to use my public IP address here. I've copied that to my clipboard. And what I can do now is run ssh-a EC2-user at, and then put in the IP address of my instance, and I should be able to connect. And there we are, we're on our instance. So I'm on the public instance, and now I want to be able to connect to my private instance. Back in EC2, let's go to our private instance, and I'm going to copy its private IP address. And now let's try and connect SSH EC2-user at, and I'm going to put in the IP. And note that I have not specified a private key file here. I'm just going to try and connect, and let's see. And that worked. So that's how you can use a Bastion host we're now connected to our instance in the private subnet via the instance in the public subnet.